around, and I want to make this as light and as fun as I can make it. And this means a lot to me, so if I get a little choked up before I'm starting, and it's happening, because I've been flooded with memories and love and so many good things. So the tears are of joy, even though it might seem counterintuitive. It's just, I just feel a lot of emotion. So a lot of you know my story, and you know my family. My mom and dad worked here for 10 years. But not everybody was here during that time. So I'm going to give a little background to my story, and especially I've gotten so many questions from the kids, like, why are you wearing that leg? And that kind of thing. And so I love curiosity, and I figured I'd start there. So because I do wear a little extra equipment to do what I do and to get around. And so I was born many years ago, 43 years ago. And you can do the math and figure out the year. But when I was born with a tissue disorder. It's a mouthful. It's called proximal femoral focal deficiency. And in the simplest terms, that just means that I didn't have the tissues in my left leg to stimulate the right growth. So basically, my thigh bone stopped growing. And they don't really know why that happened. You know, it was the 70s. It's been a different time. But my mom did take medication in her first trimester when she didn't know she was pregnant. And they think that might have been what caused the birth defect. So when I came out into the world, I was a healthy baby, but I was just missing my left leg. And some people might remember how I came to camp. In my first part of my year, since I had that, the leg there, but it just wasn't long enough. I used to wear this very stiff brace, and I kind of swung the leg out to the side. And I couldn't run. I mean, the way that I ran, I kind of just swung the leg out like this, and I tried to keep up with everybody that way. And then ultimately, we decided to have my left leg amputated above the knee. And the reason why is because the doctor said, you know, if we amputate her leg, well, I actually had three choices. So the first choice was we can amputate the leg and we can get you a better prosthesis. Or we could do an internal prosthetic. We'll put a rod in your leg and we'll lengthen it every time you grow. So you'll have many surgeries every time you grow. Or we could just leave it. And I was like, I will take the one surgery of amputation. That sounds good to me. I didn't want to have surgeries every time I grew. And I also just want to point out for the young people in the audience, we didn't have Google back then. So I couldn't really Google, and nor could my parents, about what we should maybe do. But we trusted our gut, we trusted the doctors at NYU Hospital in Manhattan, and we decided to have my left leg amputated above the knee. So when I was 7 years old, I did have that surgery, and I got this brand new prosthesis, which was a hollow wooden leg with two hinges on the side. And that's what I wore, and I got around, and I wore that to summer camp. And I remember, too, I came here as a camper. You know, we sleepaway camp, not just family camp, because my mom and dad worked at the family camp. But when I was old enough, I signed up to go to the sleepaway camp. And my dad even sent me off with a spare leg, and I had a prosthetic leg strapped to the back of my backpack when I landed here at Koinonia, because we were like, what if it breaks while she's at camp? So they sent me here with an extra hollow wooden leg with two hinges on the side. But as a kid growing up with my disability, I always felt very included in many of the events, especially here at Koinonia. I never was taught to feel different. You know, if we were going to go hike out to Homestead, Sarah was going to hike out to Homestead too. It might take me a little longer, but I wasn't going to be treated any different. And my mom really also, and my dad both, made sure that in school and everything else, I was treated just like everybody else. And there is actually a famous story that I share because I did have this experience, and I think it shaped me very much, is that my mom had also signed me up to be in a town soccer league in our town on Long Island, And so during the year, she signed me up for this soccer team. And when I show up for the practices, because of my disability, the soccer coach wouldn't let me practice with the other kids. He'd give me a soccer ball, and he'd go make me kick the soccer ball against the school building by myself, while the rest of the team got to play on the main field. And that really stuck with me. I did not like being treated different, being told I wasn't good enough to play with the other kids. But I stuck out the season, and then after that was done, I said, you know, I don't want to play soccer, and I didn't. And for a long time, I didn't participate in sports. And then we got a call. We've been coming to Koinonia for years. But Koinonia has a way of showing up in your life, even when you're not here at camp. And my dad got a call from a guy who worked as the lifeguard at the beach. Tim Ernst, I believe? Tim Ernst. Called up my dad. He'd been working in New York City at some of the hospitals. And he called my dad because he said, hey, Tom, there's a woman who's a nurse at one of the hospitals here, at Memorial Sloan Kettering and at Hospital for Special Surgery. And she's an amputee. And she started this sports group for other amputees. And she's going to be out on Long Island in your area. I think you and Sarah should go meet her. And so my dad was like, okay, we'll do that. So he got this call from his friend, Koinonia. He said, go to this race in Plainview, Long Island. And so my dad dragged my brother and I out to this race, and I have to admit, I was a bit of a snarky kid. I was mad because my dad is also the organist, and so we have to get up every Sunday without fail and go to church. And this race was on a Saturday, and they're making us get up early again to meet some lady. You know, I don't want to do this, Dad, but he's like, you're going. So he dragged us to that race, and my brother and I were standing on the sidelines cheering for everybody. And my dad had entered the race too. It was a 10K race, so double what we did today. And we're hanging out at the race waiting for my dad. And he does the race. And then we see this woman on a prosthetic leg also running the race. And I was like, wow. You mean she's not on the sidelines like I was told I was supposed to be? She's in the race? Oh my gosh. We have to meet this lady. So my brother and I rush off to the post-race thing, you know, where they have the bagels and have locks like we had today, but they had bagels and orange juice, and there I am looking in the crowd, crouched on the ground looking for this lady's legs. Like, where is this woman with the prosthetic leg? I have to find her. She's like me. And so I find her and I tap her on the shoulder and I'm like, hi, oh, my name is Sarah and I have a leg just like yours. And she's like, hi, Sarah, my name is Patty. And I come to find out that Patty was 6 years old when she had lost her leg. She was crossing the street, she's British, and she was crossing the street in London when a truck came along and ran her over. She was lucky to be alive. She walked away from that with the amputation of her leg below the knee. And she was a nurse, and she was married, and she was beautiful, and she had just done that 10K, and I also found out on that day that she had done 9 marathons on a prosthetic leg. And in that moment, she became my Michael Jordan, my LeBron James, my Serena Williams, like my total sports hero. I was like, wait, I finally saw someone that reflected my image. If she could do that on one leg, well then maybe I could. I didn't have to listen to the soccer coach. I was going to listen to this lady. And she introduced me to a man that day, a physical therapist on Long Island, actually taught me how to run, because I didn't really know how to run. What often happens when you become an amputee, you get a couple of sessions of physical therapy, they get you to the hospital, they walk you up and down that perfectly even hospital floor, and then they send you home. They don't teach you how to run. And not that you all have to run a 5K or a 10K, but it's good to know how to run if you have to run out of the building or run to catch a bus. It's just a life skill that everyone should have. Running is a right. And I didn't know how to run, so getting to the playground was always tough for me. And suddenly, Patty shifted the paradigm. If she could run, then I could run. And this physical therapist taught me how, for the first time, to run leg over leg. just like that. And she also told me about the improvements that there were in prosthetics. And so she completely changed my life. And that's really what planted the seed for me, that I could do, that I could become a runner. I went on to become a member of the U.S. Paralympic team. I had the honor, I started running. Once I started running against other one-legged folks, I realized it was actually pretty good. And I started racing in competitions on the track for both people with disabilities and without disabilities. I started to set some records, some world records. I made it to the Paralympic Games, but I never won that medal, that gold medal. So there was still a little bit of unfinished business. And one day, I was in New York. I got my legs made, still in New York to this day. I live in California, but I still go to Long Island to get my legs made. And I was at this shop on Long Island getting a fix on my leg. This was around 1992, 93. And I met a gentleman in the office there that day who was also getting some work done on his legs. And his name was Jim McLaren. And Jim McLaren had done the Hawaii Ironman on a prosthetic leg. Does everybody know what the Hawaii Ironman is? Okay. For the kids in the audience, I just want to tell you the Ironman isn't just a comic book character. It's actually a race in Hawaii. Well, the original one was in Hawaii, but in order for it to be called an Ironman triathlon, it has to be a 2.4-mile swim, 112-mile bike, followed by a 26.2-mile run, and do it all in one day. And so when I met this guy, Jim McLaren, he had done this race on one leg. I was just like, oh, you are amazing. And you're crazy. But I kind of want to be your kind of crazy. I would love to do an Ironman one day. And that's what I said to him. I said, I would just love to do an Ironman one day. Now, I'm done with the Paralympics. The Ironman would be really cool. And he looked at me and he said, I don't know any girls that can do the Ironman on one leg. And I was shocked. It was like I suddenly had that same experience with that soccer coach kind of kicked me in the gut. And I thought to myself, especially being, you know, a tough little Long Island girl, I was like, yeah, you do know the girl who's going to do the Ironman. You're looking at her. And I just resolved that one day I was going to do an Ironman just like Jim. Now, Jim, you know, many of us come to the disability club in many ways. And I always call my friends, who all have all limbs intact, I call them TABS. And that stands for Temporarily Able Bodied. Because we are all going to become part of the disability club at some point, whether it's just age or life circumstance. But my friend Jim, he has joined the club because he had started his life all limbs intact, and he went to Yale University. He was a football player. A defensive lineman at Yale, and he'd also gotten his master's from the drama school, and he was riding his motorcycle after he graduated from Yale University. He was riding his motorcycle down Fifth Avenue, and a New York City bus ran a red light and ran into him. And they actually chalked his body on the side of the street because they thought he had died, but they were able to revive him in the ambulance, and he walked away. He was lucky to walk away with only having to have his left leg amputated below the knee. And having that athlete's mindset after that injury, he said, okay, I might not get back on the football field, but I'm going to get back into living, and I'm going to become an athlete again, and I'm going to be stronger than ever. And that's when he went on to run. He did the Berlin Marathon in 3 hours and 14 minutes, and he ended up doing the Ironman. When I had met him, he'd done the Ironman in 10 hours and 42 minutes on a prosthetic leg, finishing in the top 20% of the field. So he was crushing it. And so, but about a year or two after meeting him and resolving that I was going to do the Ironman, my friend Jim was actually out in a triathlon. He was racing on streets that I live near today. It's like 2 miles from my house. He was doing this triathlon, and it was a closed bike course. And he was doing, he had a great swim, and he was doing the bike course. And a cop misjudged the speed of the cyclist coming around the corner, and he led a van onto the race course. And my friend Jim came around the corner, and he couldn't stop in time, and Norland this van, and they collided, and he broke his neck and became a quadriplegic. And we were all shocked. And I think up until that point in my life, I guess I sort of felt a little bulletproof, right? I thought, okay, I have the leg thing, this is gonna be the one bad thing that's gonna happen in my life. Okay. But we know that's not how life works. Tragedy in life is not evenly parsed. And we do not know how long we have the body that we have. And so when Jim had his second accident, I said to myself, wow, I don't know how long I'm gonna have just one leg. And if I want to do the Ironman, I don't even know how long I'm gonna be on this blue marble. So I better start training today. And that's what I did. So in 1994, I started running 5Ks. But first I did a mile, then I started doing 5Ks, then I started doing 10Ks. And by my senior year in college, I did my first New York City Marathon. And when I did that New York Marathon, I remember walking, I wore my medal on the plane. That's how half proud I was after I finished that New York Marathon. And I was walking down the aisle of the plane, like, yeah, so sore, just a marathon. And I did the marathon in like 6.5 hours. Actually, I think it was 6:52. It was a long time. I got my money's worth off that entry fee. And but I thought to myself, I'm really proud of this marathon, but my real goal was that this was the first part of this. I finished the Ironman distance of the run. Now, I was a pretty good swimmer down here at Koinonia, but one of the things that I never figured out was how to ride a bike. And so that was the big part of the Ironman that I still had to figure out. And I was a good Marco Polo swimmer, but I was not a good lap swimmer. So I still had the swim and the bike to figure out. And I lived at the time in Brooklyn, New York, and that was kind of a scary place to learn how to ride a bike. But I did, what I started doing is I just started riding an indoor bike. I just started riding on a spin bike. I got a bike trainer too. I bought a used mountain bike and I bought a bike trainer. You could make any bike a stationary indoor bike. And I would ride this little bike in my apartment, pedaling, going nowhere. But I knew that I was actually getting my bike legs ready for that race. After September 11th happened in New York, I ended up leaving New York and I moved out to California and I took a job with a nonprofit charity called the Challenge Athletes Foundation. And it was something I was passionate about because they support athletes with disabilities, and what they also do is they give away the adaptive equipment that a person with a disability would need to participate in sports. So for example, my running leg costs about $36,000. Health insurance does not pay for that because they don't see it as medically necessary. They'll get you a foot that gets you from the couch to the fridge, but they're not going to get you a running leg. So if you want to run, you'd have to pay $36,000 out of pocket to pay for that leg. And so this charity gives away running legs, we give away wheelchair, basketball wheelchairs and all that kind of stuff because it's usually cost prohibitive for people with disabilities to even get into the game. So I took this job at this charity. I'll have you know, my real goal was that I knew I could train for an Ironman in California. They have bike lanes and swimming pools outside. And so I moved out to California in 2003, and that's when I finally did, 10 years after telling Jim McLaren that I was going to do an Ironman. It was 10 years later that I actually did my first triathlon. And a year later, I made it to the Hawaii Ironman, and my whole family was there. And but the truth is I failed at my first attempt. There are cutoffs within the race. You can't just sign up and take all day, because you have to finish it within under 17 hours. But even within each sport, you have certain cutoffs. So you have to do the swim within 2 hours and 15 minutes, and the bike course, you have to be finished by 5:30. Well, I came across that line at 5:44. So I came across the line, and they take your chip away. It's like, thanks for coming. You don't even get a t-shirt. Like, that's it. So, and the other thing was, is because I was the first female amputee, or woman on a prosthetic leg, to ever attempt the Ironman, they had video cameras covering me all day. So when I came across that line 14 minutes too late, the cameras were right there to capture my failure on national TV. And so it was really a tough moment. And I think it was hard for my family, who had been there all day. And so, but immediately that afternoon, I said, you know what? I'm gonna come back and take care of my unfinished business. And the other thing that I remembered in that moment too, was the prayer that we had gotten at the dinner preparing. You know, they have a cardboard loading dinner before the race, and a minister from the Big Island came and gave us a prayer and did a speech at that event. And he told us of this Hawaiian word called imua, and it's spelled I-M-U-A, imua. And it's the spirit that we have inside of us. And the word, you know, sometimes there's a one word in a language that captures so much, but we need like five words to explain what that is in English. That's what imua is. Imua means to keep moving forward, to be resilient in the face of difficulty. And so I thought about that word imua, and I said, I have to come back to this island. I must imua. I must come back to Kona. And so I trained even harder the next year, and in 2005, I went back to Kona. I did the swim 10 minutes faster. I did the bike an hour and a half faster. Wow. And I did the marathon at 5:52. I finished the Ironman in 15 hours and 5 minutes to finally make history as the first woman on a prosthetic leg to do the Hawaii. In doing Ironman, one of the things that I want to also acknowledge in this room too is Ironman not only made me strong as a person, and it reminded me to be Koinonia tough out there, and it taught me to imua, but one of the things I'm most grateful to Ironman for is that it brought my family together. My parents split up in 1993, and it was one of the reasons we didn't get to come back to Koinonia as a whole family. But when we went to Hawaii, it didn't just teach me to imua, it taught my family to imua too. And it was so great because the first year, it was like I had my bonus dad there and my bonus mom there, and I like to call them bonus moms because I'm a bonus dad because it is truly a bonus that they are in our lives. There's nothing step about it. And so the first year, everyone was a little like cautious and not so friendly with each other. But the next year, it was like they were pros at it. Like we landed on that island, my mom, my bonus mom were like, we'll get the chalk, we'll get the water, we'll get the signs. You guys go get this. And it was like the whole team came together and it healed our family and it taught us forgiveness. And it made us imua together as a group. I mean, this is why we can be here together. We went out to dinner as a family last night. And so Ironman isn't just, to me, about achieving something or crossing a finish line. It really is about the community, the spirit. And so my family, it healed my family, and that has been a great thing. And I'm so proud of that happened at Ironman. Beyond that, after Ironman, I was like, okay, what do I do next? What do you do after achieving something like that? Well, this year I had the opportunity to do something really, really cool. And I did this race called the World Marathon Challenge. I got to run 7 marathons, 7 days on 7 continents. And there's only 104 people that have done that in the world. And I am the only amputee to have ever achieved that race. We ran in Antarctica, Cape Town, Perth, Dubai, Lisbon, Cartagena, and Miami. And my family, my bonus mom, my mom, and everybody was there at the finish. And and it was really special. But about a month ago, I found out, since it's the 40th anniversary of the Hawaii Ironman, I was invited back to go back to Kona and to race the Hawaii Ironman again. So I'm getting ready to go back to the Big Island this October in 140 days. And my family will all be there, and I'm gonna race Kona again. And I'm so excited to do that. But the truth of the matter is, I don't really stand up here to tell you my achievements just because I want to impress you. I really share my story with you today because I want to impress upon you the possibility that exists in all of our lives. To embrace the life that we have. And I said it before the race, but to embrace the body that we have. I do believe when I'm out there swimming, biking, and running, I am celebrating God's work. I am showing what's possible. And I want to remind all of you what's possible, because really, each of us, I don't have any special sauce inside my body. I'm not any different than any of you in this room. We all have what it takes inside of us to imua and to face our challenges head on, to dig deep, to adapt, to carry forward, even when the winds blow, even when the heat beats down, and even when it looks like someone like you might not be able to achieve that. I've been told that my whole life, but you can persevere, you can adapt, and you can reach Ironman finish lines in your own life. So thank you for listening to my story. Thank you for coming out and supporting Koinonia and getting out and doing the 5K. And I want us all to be more in our own lives, but for this place too, we need to be come together as a family, find forgiveness, find love, and emua for the community that we built here. So thank you.